Namaste and good evening. I,
Namaste.
Swati Solanki, researcher at IMPRI, Impact and Policy Research Institute, Prabhav, Evam Niti Anusandhan Sansthan, Nai Delhi, extend my warmest welcome to you all to IMPRI hashtag Web Policy Talk. Today, we have gathered for a special talk on the future of labor codes, impact and way forward from trade union perspectives as a part of the series The State of Employment and Livelihood, hashtag Employment Debate. The series is organized by Center for Work and Welfare at IMPRI with Indian Social Institute, New Delhi, and Counterview. It is my privilege to introduce the chair for our session, Father Dr. Denzel Fernandez. Sir is Executive Director at Indian Social Institute, New Delhi. The moderator of our today's session is Professor K.R. Shyam Sundar. Sir is a professor at XLRI Xavier School of Management, Jamshedpur. I would now like to introduce our esteemed panelists for today's talk. We have with us very eminent leaders from trade unions for this very important discussion. We have with us Amarjeet Kaur. Ma'am is General Secretary at All India Trade Union Congress, AITUC. We welcome you, ma'am. Amitava Guha, who is National Secretary at Center of Trade, Indian Trade Unions, CITU. We welcome you, sir. Chandra Prakash Singh, sir is National Vice President at Indian National Trade Union Congress, INTUC. We welcome you, sir. Virjesh Upadhyay, sir is associated with research and intellectual work at Bhartiya Mazdoor Sangh, BMS, and is Director General at Dattopant Thengari Foundation. As discussants for this panel discussion, we have with us Prashant K. Nanda, who is National Writer at Livemint, and Rashmi Venkatesan, who is Assistant Professor of Law at National Law School of India University, Bangalore. Now, I invite our moderator, Professor K.R. Shyam Sundar, to initiate the discussion and invite our chair for opening remarks and to take this panel discussion forward. We look forward to learning from our esteemed gathering on this very important topic amidst the ongoing monsoon session of the Parliament session. So, over to you. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, IMPRI. Thanks, Dr. Arjun Kumar. And thanks, Swati Solanki, for your introductory remarks. Introducing the panelists and discussants and the chairperson for the program. I request Father Denzel Fernandez to give his opening remarks, and then I will carry forward the session. Over to you, Father.
Thank you, Professor Shyam Sundar, and warm good evening to all the panelists and the discussants and all the viewers of this web policy talk. Web policy talk on the future of labor codes is a very, very important discussion, because we all know that the labor codes were passed in the last year or so, and the rules have also come out. But there has been sort of a polarized reaction to the labor codes. On the one hand, we have the industry, like the Confederation of Indian Industry, who says that these labor codes will build a future of work that is progressive, safer, fairer, greener, and more resilient. That is what they say. And the union government also says that it is necessary to bring these labor codes to bring the national economy back on track. But having said that, today we are focusing on the trade union perspective, and workers and the trade unions have expressed a lot of reservations on the labor codes. The reactions have been, like the labor codes is a modern form of slavery, where the working class is forced by its miserable financial conditions to work on whatever exploitative terms an employer wants to employ its members for. And the workers have several grievances, which include the sweeping powers given to employers against the workforce. And there is a fear that the labor codes is putting the workers mercy of the employers, and the working conditions will also deteriorate, as we have already seen how many states have been increasing the number of working hours a day. So context, it is very important to focus on the trade union perspective, because the trade unions represent the workers. They represent not only the workers that are members of this union, but also the large unorganized sector, which is not covered also by labor unions. So I'm happy that this discussion is taking place. And
ek meeting mein hum hai.
With this,
Professor
Shyam Sundar as the moderator, I'm sure we are going to have an interesting discussion. I wish this discussion all the best, and we hope we have a way forward on these labor codes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Father Denzel Fernandez. You have set the context very nicely by clearly giving away the polarized perspectives that exist on the labor law reforms. Now, this particular panel discussion is going to concentrate on the future of the labor codes that have already been passed by the parliament during 2019 and 2020. The future is going to be discussed. And we all know that based on the recommendations of the Second National Commission on Labor, the India government initiated codification of the so-called numerous labor laws. The count was always 44, but in B schools and other universities, we don't teach more than 19, 20 labor laws which belong to the organized sector. If we count all of them, even if we take the entire number of laws that the four labor codes have managed to codify, which is a good, which is a big question mark to me, are 29. So it's not numerous, but anyway, we all know the criticisms. We all know the neoliberal agenda has taken over, and the labor codes have been, excepting the wage code, the other three codes have been passed in unusual circumstances. That is during the COVID times, and when the parliament was almost empty, save the treasury benches, and it's questionable. Now, this webinar is not going to look back at what happened and how foul or fair it was, the passage of the labor law, labor codes, etc. But we have the labor codes now notified. They are gazetted. And the labor minister, the labor secretary had assured the nation, the foreign investors, everyone that from April 1st, 2021, the labor codes will come into effect. But owing to the lack of preparedness on the part of the state governments, the date of implementation has been suggestively postponed to October 1st, 2021. Now, what I did a quick check on the labor codes, how prepared are the state governments are. Where have they framed the rule? The central government have framed the rules, but they are yet to notify the final revised rules. They are waiting for the state governments to be prepared. I just looked at the state governments. I find that big states like Tamil Nadu, Kerala, West Bengal, Maharashtra, Haryana have not, as on date today, have not notified the first draft of the rules under the all the four labor codes. That is Tamil Nadu, Kerala, West Bengal, Maharashtra, Haryana. Of course, Delhi is a small state. And states like Karnataka, Gujarat, and Jharkhand have framed rules only with respect to the wage code and the industrial relations code. The biggest deficit comes when we look at the rules framed under Occupational Safety and Health and Working Conditions Code and the Social Security Code, which are far more important and have a lot of impact on the welfare and social security and occupational safety and health of the workers. This is a big blank. Now, there are five states have framed the draft rules for all the four labor codes, which are Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand, and Punjab. Now, I not looked at the northeastern states, including Assam. Assam, of course, I've done a few. So there is a huge, even as we speak on August 3rd, there is still a huge void. We are still looking at the first draft of the rules framed by the state governments. So the question number one that I wish to pose to the moderators is that, is October 1 a likely date of implementation for the four labor codes at the national level, given the lack of preparedness on the part of the various state governments that I have listed? Of course, the trade union, we have a formidable group of union leaders representing the central trade unions, Comrade Amitava Guga from CATU, Mr. Vijay Subhadeya from BMS, Mr. Chandraprakash Singh from INTUC, and Comrade Amarjit Kaur from AATUC. We all know the trade union perspective that there are a lot of faults in the codes. But one could have an opening remark of highlighting the shortcomings according to them in the codes or in the rules. But I would request the panel discussion to take the discussion forward in terms of the future and the strategy of the trade unions. For example, has there been any social dialogue happening on the rules front or on the codes, or any possibility of amendments that is likely to happen? And more importantly, what is happening at the state level? There's a huge void on we don't have information excepting those who are specialized in the field of law to go to the specialized portals to know what is happening at the state level. If some of them could throw light on what is happening at the state level, it will be very important. But most importantly, what is going to be the strategy of the trade unions? There is some talk by some union leaders like Mr. Sanjay Singhvi and some advocates, noted advocates like Corin Gonzalez, to say that they're going to challenge the constitutional validity of the labor codes, or that the very notion of the labor codes in the Supreme Court. Whether the trade unions are going to join hands with them, is litigation going to be the strategy? Some trade unions have asked for total withdrawal, revocation of the labor code, or is it going to be amendments of the labor codes? And what are the legal cells of the central trade unions doing? Are they working on making amendments to be submitted to the government? There are two strategies, either revocation, litigation, or progressive amendments via the parliament route. And is there any way that ILO could be involved in the reworking of the labor codes in a constructive manner? I'm very sorry to note here that Government of India has not utilized the ILO's technical assistance the way some countries like China had used. I had done in-depth research on China's labor law reforms in 2008. And I spoke to ILO officials there, and China could consult ILO. I have not seen any reports saying that Indian government has consulted with ILO in any way. My final question is that, why did not the central trade unions join the farmers' agitation of revocation of farm laws by asking for revocation of the four labor codes? Did they miss the golden opportunity? Did would they have not joined the farmers education and asked for revocation, if at all it is, if they are going to ask for revocation? Personally, that is not the line that I advocate, but strategically, have they missed a golden chance? These are some of the teasers that I post to them, and I look forward to an exciting discussion, and I'm sure there are many people, students are attending from XLRI and this and other places. And I request the panelists to take the discussion forward by looking at the future or the strategy. I know they will not be able to tell whatever they have in their midst, but some broad outline and their views, that would be helpful. So with these preliminary remarks, of course, we have, I want to say that we have Dr. Rashmi Venkatesan, who is a well-known professor of labor law. And we are also having a very well-known national reporter, Mr. Prashant Ananda, to be reporting. He works for the Mint paper. So with these preliminary remarks, may I now request to Comrade Amitav Guha, National Secretary, Center of Indian Trade Unions, to start the discussion. Thank you very much.
Amitav, sir, you will have to unmute. Yeah.
I think I am audible.
Yes, you are audible. Please go ahead.
So, good evening, everybody. And I thank the organizers, including Father Fernandez, Shyam Sundar, and others for inviting me to attend this meeting. I will precisely say a couple of things. First point is that the title of this meeting, Future of Courts, but I will speak on the future of trade union rights in the perspective of the courts. So I had a different title for my speaking. And then the one or two issues out of the track I want to mention here. For example, Shyam Sundar, Professor Shyam Sundar has said the participation of lay workers in the vision movement is full force participation. Maybe you are not briefed about it, that at least CITU and the left trade unions, we have been regularly meeting with the peasant leaders, our farmer leaders. We talk to them, take joint program. We have in states, districts, we have involved our people in the movement and spreading the message of the farmers' agitation. So we are fully involved in them. In fact, we have been very thickly engaged in farmers, peasants, and workers' unity, and we are performing things accordingly. Now, coming to the labor rights, I would say first that these codes, there is hardly any scope for the codes to be amended or discussed anything. I can give you instances that right at the beginning of the codes, the central trade unions, for example, my trade union, CITU, we have given amendments to all the codes and rules. And before that, we insisted the government to have dialogue with the central trade unions. Government called a brief web meeting, which we boycotted. We said that 10-minute speech from each trade union cannot discuss all the four codes in such a short time. So if you have an intention to discuss, you have a full-fledged discussion for each code. And it requires rigorous discussion. For example, there was a discussion on the wage rules organized by ILO from morning 11 to night 9 o'clock we discussed. And Advocate Ramapriya assisted us in the framing the amendments. So all 10 central trade unions together, we have prepared our amendment to the working rules, rules on the wages. We have sent it to the government. And later on, we have all attended the meetings called by the Joint Parliamentary Committee. So all our recommendations and even the recommendations of the Parliamentary Committee has not been heard by you. let alone ILO. So government has been unidirectionally moving, preparing their codes and passing it stealthily during a position when the parliament, there was no opposition. So as far as parliament record goes, it will show that the code was presented and few moments later, it was all the codes were passed. And there was no opposition, no voice of protest or opposition from the other side. So that will go on the record. Now the problem is this, as far as future of the workers is concerned, the claim made by the government that they are, the courts have been aimed to universalize the facilities and benefits and the legal coverage for everybody. But it is otherwise. For example, that the court has straightway rejected to involve the agricultural workers who constitute about 49% of the total working force. So 49% of the working force are kept away. Then there are about 25 areas which we have marked, enlisted and given to the government in our submission, that all these sectors, workers, very large amount of workers, for example, gig workers, scheme workers, and many other varieties of workers are not covered under this code. Therefore, the code deprives a large amount of workers under its coverage. Similarly, there are lot of thresholds prepared by in the codes, and the thresholds are given in an increased amount than the previous trade union laws. As a result, more and more people are thrown out. Then there are various processes. If you find out in totality, a vast amount of workers are thrown out. And the thresholds are increased. For example, lockout declaration thresholds is increased. In case of your PF, ESI, we have said that reduce the threshold so that a vast amount of workers who are not covered under social security, this benefit should be given to them. So they have not included them. So they have not only included, in many places, they have enhanced the threshold so that more and more workers are deprived from the benefits of the trade union. This is evident. I am not making any postulations or any observations out of the context. So if you go through the code, you will find that a vast amount of workers are now would be deprived. Then come the issues about the recognition of trade unions. I do not want to go by clause or in details because of the time limits and repetition could be, because most of us in this panel, we know the codes, contents of the codes, we have involved in criticism and everybody knows. But I just want to highlight a couple of things that why we are worried about the future of trade union rights. For example, the codes, four codes and a lot of the working rules have been also prepared. And some working rules are more rigorous and some working rules are deceptive. Some working rules are depriving more workers, more than the codes. For example, there was in the working rule, they have increased the working hours. Working hours, number one convention of ILO is violated. And when the states said that they will push people, 13 states, they said that we will not allow the, in the COVID period or then thereafter also, will enhance the working hours per day. That violates the ILO's convention number one. So we central trade unions, we jointly filed complaint to this ILO. ILO has issued letter to the government that they should see that the state should not insist for work enhanced working hours. It has not worked. The government or anybody in the states and anywhere, they do not bother what the advisories are coming from ILO. So there's the ILO's limitation. For example, recently, we have written very thoroughly that how the imposition of defense sector ordinance, that ordinance violates umpteen number of ILO decisions, ILO's convention, etc., open flouting of these things. And only yesterday we found that ILO has sent the complaints made by trade unions. We, CITU, and our AITUC also made complaint against this. So they have sent the whole complaints to the government for their response on the complaints we have made. So therefore, there are umpteen number of violations spreaded around. And then the major 2-3 issues I wanted to say, which has already put people into trouble, or workers into trouble. One is fixed-term employment. This fixed-term employment in the court, it was very, from the behind the parliament, it was pushed initially. Now it has been accommodated in the court, making it a legal entity. That fixed-term employment, it is a frank deception of the basic fundamental rights of workers. And following this, many large sector companies, particularly in automobiles, they have started recruiting people massively in the fixed-term employment. And fixed-term employment, what deception? They said that they will enjoy all the facilities like other workers. They said that they will also get gratuity. Gratuity, they say that after 5 years work, they will get gratuity. But fixed-term employment is for temporary being. Anytime they will be thrown out, five years will never be accessible to any of them. It's a great deception. And this is an opportunity given to the employers to create a worse conditions for worse than the contractual workers' condition. People will be recruited. They have already started recruiting. People will be recruited, and then they will be temporary, and they will replace the permanent workers, regular workers. That's the process they have legalized. That's the problem for us. They have legalized these temporary workers. Then think about the fundamental rights, trade union registration. I do not want to go into details. First of all, they say that 10% is the eligibility criteria for registration. This 10% to get 10% workers in larger sectors, it's practically impossible. And then even if you fulfill the conditions, right has been given to the authorities, even after you fulfill all the conditions, your registration may be canceled. Their registration may not be approved. And you don't have any scope to go for challenging it. And because you are, till that time, you are not registered, you cannot challenge it like all other already registered trade unions. So there are problems. Second, see, the very formation of trade union has been challenged, has been compromised with these laws. And then if you think about the another fundamental right, right to strike. Right to strike means what? It is practically, it has been made impossible. You will have to take permission for this, for going into strike. Earlier, it was only for essential service sector, but now it has been given to everybody. So to go for a strike, if you go through the clauses of the Industrial Relations Code, you will find that they say that you will have to give a notice 2 weeks before the strike you have decided. And then it will be sent to the conciliation. Conciliation officer will call both the parties. He will go ahead with the conciliation. Now, if the conciliation officer has some conflict of interest with the employers, he can stretch it with any plea for a long time. And even after the verdict is given, after 60 days, you can go for action. Before 60 days, you can. So virtually, to go for a strike would be virtually impossible. And even if, and then other thing they have done, they have given two major things for the employers, that all the provisions, the employers are given umpteen amount of exemptions, and the workers are given stringent punishment clauses, 25,000 rupees for calling or participating illegal strike, etc. When the strike is declared illegal, the leaders will be caught and they'll put behind bars, or they'll be fined, penalized for 25,000. So there are lot many things they have given employers to utilize it. For example, they have reduced the wage quantum by taking away the allowances and other benefits. So the real takeaway package is reduced, and the legal dues to be recovered from the workers' wages for their future would also be reduced, resulting to a term that at the time of retirement, at the time of retrenchment, they will get much, much less than what they would have used to get it from the previous laws and acts. There has been every level of penal provisions things are reduced. Everywhere it is reduced. Then most importantly, the CESS fund is a very big question, that there are large amount of CESS fund has been totally abolished, like BD workers, like the mine workers, like the Cine workers. All the CESS funds have been abolished. And the huge amount of money accumulated, for example, in BOCU, building another construction workers, CESS, the board, they have accumulated several thousand crores of money in their fund, which has not been utilized. What will be the future of this fund? And what will be the CESS amount and how the CESS will be collected, disbursed, etc.? Then again, umpteen number of leverage has been given to the employers in the way of giving lot many benefits for them to deprive the workers. As I have said, that the even in the EPF, for example, EPF, the whole system has been changed in such a manner that the board for the that central board of trustees, this has been, their role has been diluted. They had no power. They will have no power, no decision-making position, although it has not fully abolished. But then the state boards for the these things workers had been abolished. So there has been this kind of benefits that have been given, and the penalties in every stages are reduced for the employers. Then there are infringement of internal matters. See that there has been infringement in holding the meetings, and internal matter of the unions are also infringed, because they have, for example, in the code, in the they have issued the new process for representation of the trade unions. In the representation of the trade unions, there are 10 clauses, excepting number one clause, which is giving the definition. All the clauses are rejected. All the clauses are impossible to put it. And I'm very briefly, I'm saying that it is also interfering the internal right of the trade unions, that how you will have your meetings, how many process you will follow. For example, that selection, the employers will prepare, they will appoint the people for verifying the membership of the union. Just imagine, the employers will be deputing person of their own choice for verifying, for taking the, during the attending the meeting and taking the vote of the workers, employer will put it. Earlier it was given to the labor authorities. Now it is employers have been given. Employers have been empowered to feed them, to give them money. Everything has been designed in such a manner that the total thing, the selection and representation of the recognition of the trade unions will become a first. Then comes the issue that this also says that you have the, after this, if you have any problem with any members of yours, if you want to penalize your or put a punishment for your own members for violation of the trade union's rights and other things, it will be judged by the authorities. Your internal democracy will be taken away by the authorities. Like that, there are umpteen number of things which are existing things have been taken away, and representation of the trade unions will automatically reduce, or it will be cut. New representation will be in a problem, and it will be automatically cut, and many trade unions will lose their right to representation. So these are the things I wanted to point out. Number one, that umpteen number of benefit has been given, both in the way of wages and earning, by snatching away the rights of the workers, and penal provisions, and the provisions of the CESS. Everything has been given to the employers for their benefit, and workers are squeezed to the end, and finally they will not be able to perform their basic trade union fundamental rights. And now, as Professor Shamsundar very rightly pointed out, before I end, I wanted to put one or two points. For example, what ILO can do? ILO cannot do anything. The government never bothered. government do not believe in tripartism. We have been asking ILO to involve in it. There was a committee of tripartite committee of conventions. This ILO conventions, tripartite committee is abolished, nowhere called. The Indian Labour Conference has been abolished after 2015. No meeting has been called so far. Despite our reminder, nothing has been called. So this government do not believe the ILO's fundamental process of tripartism. And this has been followed so far. Any damn government has come, they have not abolished this tripartism. This government do not believe on tripartism. Particularly workers and trade unions are assured to them. So therefore, trade unions had to go for further militant program. Amendment of the laws question doesn't arise. They will not listen. Already parliamentary committee, trade unions written representation for each courts and rules had been ignored deliberately. Therefore, they will not listen any amendment. There is hardly any scope after it is passed in the parliament. And who will speak in the parliament? Today's parliament has become real farce. So one-sided arbitrary move is going on. Here trade unions, for example, my central trade union, we have decided to go for higher phase of movement. We will defy everything. Already we have told our unions to notify their management that they will not work beyond 8 hours. Say whatever, what comes or no. So they will definitely tell, they will represent, they'll give it representative to their employers that they will not work beyond 8 hours, and the previous system of overtime work should be utilized. No further increase of working hours, nothing. And the labor secretary said that what's the problem? 12 hours work they will do and 3 days they will give leave. He doesn't know that he is making this rule for more work, but then the parent act, which is a labor code doesn't allow. He went beyond the labor code when he formulated the rules. So these are the things they are doing, whatever they like. It is an absolute traversity of truth. It is a trampling of the fundamental right of the workers, and workers are geared up now to go for larger movement and intensify their agitation against this code. So all the central trade unions have rejected, 10 central trade unions have rejected wholeheartedly, whole hog rejected the codes and the rules. And with that, we are going already, our workers have burned the codes. A day has been observed. They will go for higher phase of movement. We are gearing up our organization to do that. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, comrade, for a very incisive analysis of the labor codes. Perhaps you have set the stage for others to, not to dwell much on the shortcomings of the labor codes. You have comprehensively covered the shortcomings in the labor codes, and you have seen labor codes is equal to labor trade union rights. And I just want to dispel one particular point of mine, there could be my articulation problem. I said that along with the farmers' agitation for revocation of farm laws, why did not the central trade unions also demand or think of the strategy to demand revocation of the 4 labor codes? I did not say that central trade unions did not support the farmers' agitation or take forward the farmers' agitation. I said that parallelly, could there have been a movement on the part of central trade unions and the working class, industrial working class, demanding revocation of 4 labor codes? That was my question.
No. Shamsundar, I understand you. I sent all my circulars, major circulars, to you. So you will find in some of the circulars we have informed everybody that all the 10 central trade unions, through their joint representation, they asked revocation of the all codes and the rules.
I'm aware, comrade. But I thought, Situ could have done it internally, but as a movement. As a movement, was there any? Why did the central trade unions did not come together? If there was a consensus, that was my question in terms of movement. No. I understand. I am aware all the trade unions are protesting.
Please listen. I will send you again the 7 points common charter we have prepared jointly by the central trade unions, where your all postulations are already accommodated. So yeah. No anxiety is required. You have already done it. My partner or our leader, Amarjit, is there. She will also put more information, but we have already done it. So
yeah, thanks. They are in print. I was talking on the movement on the streets. But you have given a very broad perspective of a critique of the labor codes. But I would now request the other trade union leaders to concentrate more on their future strategies and what they think of litigation, ILO, having a mass movement or a micro level dissent, what they have in their bag. So building on what Comrade Amitav Guha has given, a widespread critique of the labor codes, we are all aware of various deficits and various ways in which the labor rights are getting hurt. So we would like to hear more on the future strategy, a concrete strategy, if there is any, or also on the trade union unity fringe. And what they are going to do also, one question is that a lot of state governments have introduced a lot of labor reforms. One question I have is that what is the need for the national labor code? Everything is done at the state level. The trade unions are caught unaware of that. So with these remarks, I request Mr. Chandraprakash Singh, National Vice President, INTUC, to take the discussion forward on the future strategy, on the strategy of the trade unions and the future of the labor force. Thank you very much.
Okay, brother. Sam Sundarji, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Namaste to all of you and our veteran central trade union leaders, Sister Amarjit Kaur and Amitab Guha and Brajesh Upadhyay ji. I, on behalf of INTUC, pay my respect to Father Denzel Fernandez, Sam Sundar ji, Prashant K. Nanda, Rashmi Venkatesan, and Arjun ji also. Who are participating in this meeting also. I am thankful for inviting me to this program. The subject on which you have called to discuss a very serious matter and is related to more than 400 million toiling workers of the country. We cannot talk on this matter only confined to some sections of courts or rules, because on the shoulders of these toiling laborers, workers, the responsibility to develop the country, building infrastructure, and taking forward the various sectors of employment and production, as well as service and health sectors of the country. Unfortunately, even after 74 years have gone of independence, we do not want to understand the importance of these poor workers. Better measures are not being taken regarding their service or work security, service conditions, about their salary and social security, etc. Now in a days, you see how many government jobs will be available in the coming time. This has become a big question. Till few years back, we could clearly see the difference between organized and unorganized sector. But today, the situation has completely changed. Now the unorganized sector employment is increasing in all the organized sector as well. The nature of employment has completely changed. Now employment of permanent nature will be a matter of history in the coming times. Now more jobs are available as a contract labor and limited time only. But you can say as a term employment. And implementation of labor laws in such employment will not even be possible. We are facing today also. As far as the trade union are concerned, the government has inserted many such provisions in the industrial relations codes rules, due to which the power of the union will be greatly weakened. We will also discuss some of the provisions, but you have, as Sam Sundarji has told, that already brother Amitabh Guha has elaborated so many provisions, so I will not tell about that. And but in the meantime, I greatly thankful to Father Fernandez, who have clearly what he told. This is our views also, and also brother Sam Sundar has told. So I will not go on that quote section. We will also discuss before that, as an example. Just I want to give an example. I want to tell that both the policy and the intention of the central government, you will understand what I'm telling. There is a big conspiracy to take away the constitutional, democratic, and legal rights of the employees involved in defense sector. You can see the defense production through the Essential Defense Services Ordinance 2021, brought recently by the central government, and attacked on the right to a strike. Even you go for agitation, they will send to jail. They will make an FIR and send to jail. So what the government is doing, I not only myself, but everybody, you better know about this. On the one hand, lakhs of people, you see the situation of today. The country is suffering. Lakhs of people have lost their lives due to the dreadful grip of COVID-19 epidemic in the entire country. Even at this time, instead of fighting with epidemic, the central government is fighting with the farmers, laborers, and the common people of the country, who are agitating for their demands and rights. Against the farmers and laborers of the country, the central government made the COVID-19 epidemic an opportunity. And during this corona period, Parliament passed 3 black laws of relating to the farmers, and also 3 black labor codes related to the laborers. The whole country is struggling with the problems like inflation, unemployment, education, and health. And the central government is making every conspiracy to end the labor and farmers movement, as well as mass movement also. As for the subject, today's subject is concerned, what will be the effect of the labor codes in future on labor movements, or on the service condition of the workers, or on the social security and implementation of the labor laws. You see, 4 labor codes rules, just what is the views of all central trade unions. I want to make it clear that the alliance of the central trade unions in the country, including INTUC, have decided that labor reforms in the name of ease of doing business will not be accepted, and our protest will continue against the government approach, and that is being given that the power is given to the capitalists and the multinational companies through these reforms. We cannot accept this codification under any circumstances. It is unfortunate that the central government has closed the meeting of Indian Labour Conference since 2015. The policy-making platform of the workers of the country, the central government has weakened the traditional bilateral dialogue. The government is not ready to consider the trade union views. Central trade union organizations are continuously fighting this anti-worker move of the government. We also in close contact with the ILO office. As you questioned about the ILO, what we are doing with the ILO. So I want to clear you that we are close contact with the ILO, but as brother Amitabh told, that the ILO has limited power to intervene in the country matter, but from time to time, representative of the ILO, together with the representatives of the central trade unions, have presented a number of suggestions regarding the labor codes rules, but the government is not ready to accept even the ILO's proposal also. The parliament has also ratified, you know, ILO Convention 144. This is good. But despite its ratification, the government is not ready for bilateral dialogue or tripartite dialogue. In this, today, I Brijesh Upadhyay ji, who is representing BMS, I would like to congratulate BMS for the letter written in this regard to the Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi ji, in which they have also demanded to convene a meeting of the Indian Labour Conference. Friends, crores of people have lost their jobs and during this COVID pandemic. Along with this, the central government needs to consider this by convening a meeting of Indian Labour Conference regarding, you see, salary cut is still continuing in many factories and organizations. Problems of migrant laborers are continuing. Labor reforms, still you are seeing what is happening. Condition of unorganized workers, social securities, and deteriorating economic condition of women of this country, etc. So immediately government should call the Indian Labor Conference to hear all this matter. As far as the old labor laws have been abolished and brought in new form of the new labor laws against the interest of, it is totally against the interest of worker. With regard to labor laws, the government has completely confused the situation. They are not even announcing what the labor code will finalize. They are talking since last 7 years. They have put in abeyance all the labor laws previously and not implementing even today's labor department is not working, and new labor courts are also in pendulum. So the government has completely put on hold the investigation of complaints regarding violation of labor laws also. The inspector will now meet the managers of the institution as a facilitator. They will not inspect the factory, and they will not file the complaint against the management against the violation of the labor laws, but they will facilitate them. They will request them to follow the labor laws, but they will not do anything. The workers can take initiative. You see, just Amitabh, my brother Amitabh was telling, the workers can take initiative from the management regarding their problems and demands to negotiate. But the government has made arrangements to stop the agitation and their strike as well, and have made it punishable. You see, when you will put the demand with the management, this and you have to give the copy to the conciliation officer, when you will serve the demand, the same time, you have to presume that conciliation has just started. Even conciliation is not started, but you have to presume that conciliation is just started, and you will not go for agitation and a strike. This is the provision in the Industrial Relations Code. So you can imagine how the government will, how the workers will protest and workers will go on a strike. So the role of the ministry, and now the role of the Ministry of Labor, or the department, labor department in the state, as per the instruction of the central government, has now become very soft towards the employer. The central government talks about amending labor laws to support the management on ease of doing business, privatization, term employment, outsource, But government doesn't talk about the decent work, universal social security, living wage, security of job or work, and a strict implementation of labor laws. A big question arises about the better future of the hardworking laborers in coming time. And the labor organization of the country have to continuously find the answer of this situation. So I would like to draw your attention about this, all the central trade unions, we have to find the answer of this situation. And if we will simply fight, government is not going to hear anything of the workers' movement. So anything you want to, you are raising your hand, Brother Sam Sundar. But you see, just you see two, three points I want to say that even in the, when you will see the industrial relations code or provision of on trade unions, right to a strike, everything, even retrenchment threshold, all you know, I don't want to go on this clause by clause or section by section, but only I want to say that you have rightly said that we have to plan about the future course of action about labor codes, how we can stop it. But we have also raised the question about the farmers' agitation, how we have any coalition with the farmers' movement or not. As Brother Amitabh has told, we have. Okay, when you will clear, I will tell. But we are coalition with the farmers' movement. We have also raised that withdraw the three farmers' laws as well as the four labor codes also. We are not asking about any amendment. We are not going to accept any amendment. We have strictly demanded that you withdraw this labor code. That's all. Thank you very much, Brother Sam Sundar.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chandra Prakash Singh, for articulating the views of one of the central trade unions, INTUC. So the mood that is that is emanating from the two discussions is that the central trade unions do not accept the labor codes and the rules as they are in the current form. So they are knocking at the doors of the government for social dialogue. They are also working with the ILO. Now, you have also pointed out various limitations in the central labor codes, but still my sense of there is a sense of unease in my mind that are the trade unions becoming desperate that this government will not listen, nothing will happen. So I would like to know from the remaining two, is there any kind of political mobilization?
But I want to clarify, not we are not frustrated or
I am it is an unease in my mind.
We are clear about this, that government is not ready to hear anything.
I understand that the government is not responsive to the voices of the trade unions. Then how to get around this? That is a conundrum, that is a problem that
we have also invited BMS to join this movement.
Yeah, because because
time to time they are also opposing the government move. So it will be nice to have a joint movement, and BMS should also join the hand with the central trade unions.
I will leave it to Mr. Upadhyaya to make his own observations. And I am thankful to you, Mr. Chandra Prakash Singh, for for strengthening the powerful voices of protests and contestation made by Comrade Amitabh Guha. you also said that the government has not considered even the proposals from ILO. That would be a very interesting thing to know more about. But I think I will wait to hear from Mr. Brijesh Upadhyaya, who was the ex-national secretary of BMS and currently the currently the director general of research and intellectual department of BMS. Sir, over to you. and please let's talk about the future of labor codes and the trade union strategy. And you may respond to Mr. Chandraprakash Singh's invite for Unity Front. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Respected chair of this session, Father Fernandes, and my very near and dear friend, Shyam Sundarji, who called me to be here. I am really thankful to him. My colleagues and panelists, Sister Amarjeet Kaur, Brother Amitabh Guha, and of course, my very lovely friend, C.P. Singh Ji. Again, Prashant Nanda Ji, very closely to, and other academics, Dr. Arjun Kumar and others. And the audience, those who are connected over web portal. Warm greetings from BMS to all of you. The content of today, the future of labor code impact and way forward. I especially for this purpose have a very different perspective to speak here. Different, I mean, not that much difference. It will be very close to approach Shyam Sundarji has made here. I don't want to go into postmortem job. What happened? How happened? I think it is not going to serve the purpose. The purpose of today is what is happened, it is already. What trade unions are supposed to do to overcome from this situation. So when I go into this aspect, so sometime I feel whether this should be called labor laws. I find no merit to call it labor law. It is business law. After independence of 75 years, so far we could not bring the employment policy. Industrial policy has been brought number of times, its revision, this, that. And equally, we could not bring the labor laws. The laws so far we are terming it in labor law. It is actually how to govern the business. And the components coming on the way to govern the business, there is a labor also, so they are addressing the labor also. Otherwise, if you recall the recent economic survey, 93% of workforce is in the informal sector. So 93% is out of ambit of this labor law. And again, rest 7% workers, those who are employed directly by the government, again, they are not part of these labor laws. If you go and audit practically, so how much it is going to cover? 3%, 4%, whatever. I'm not going to the data, but a very small fraction of workforce is coming under the labor laws. So I have a very big issue to discuss, to debate wherever I'm going, I'm asking, even I'm asking governments also, whether really these are intending to address the labor laws, labor concerns, so it is not. If you see in these four codes, what IR code says and what OSH code says, these two are exclusively addressing the business and how to protect the business, their boundaries, their working, rest of the things, and how to keep workers away. A very little small protection is given. Again, because Shyam Sundarji said, and I also think going into class by class, which is class, what it is saying, I need not to. We all are aware to that. My big and bold issue is it should not be called labor laws. Labor laws should be thought afresh, as the Second Labor Commission has observed, as many other academics are coming, and what the ground reality is, putting all the laborers, formal, informal, together, their welfare, their rights, if it is not ensured, it is not the labor laws. It is one issue. The very next issue is, talking about the labor laws whatsoever, it's a book arrangement and it's a practical implementation. There are the two aspects to discuss. Discussing the book arrangement, to whom it is going to serve? We are having contract labor regulation, abolition. You know, Shyam Sundar ji knows, he's a master man. After bringing this law, whether we could stop the contractualization, it has gone number of time ahead. So the question comes whether these book-based laws or arrangements are working, helping the labor practically, actually. If not, what are the rules? The last year migrant issues, it is sometime 79 or what, who knows this? So what rules means for the persons, those who needs to get it implemented, if it is not enforced, not implemented, whatever reason may be, again, there's a big issue. For a poor person, for a worker, having rule and having no rule, they have no meaning to. And the third question is, concern of the leaders and concern of the common man. Again, there are the aspects to address and the bridge the gap between the approach of the leaders and a necessity, practical aspect of the workers at the ground. Putting all these 2, 3, 4, 5 issues together, I am strongly of the opinion labor laws should be thought fresh, bring a fresh, considering entire workers, maybe part of salary structure or maybe own account, whatever term we are using so far, entire workforce should be part of legislation, then it will be called as a labor law. And the very next one is, so far our struggle, we need to focus what is missing in this. Enforcement is a big issue. Even after having laws, its implementation has become an issue. My brother Guha has said, my brother CP Singh has expressed, rules are there but not implemented, ILC is not, lot of things are there. And if it is not, then what? Simply, our observations will work. Are some action required to be? When it comes to action, then what action? And I have told, when we have been sitting jointly, I told my friends, we all had been there. That time, Comrade Gurdas, he was there. And all the senior leaders were there. We were sitting inside the room. I asked them, we are sitting inside the room. We need to think whether our practices so far is converting into result or getting it benefited to the persons for whom we are struggling, fighting. I said, okay, after moving out of this room, we will say in very fiery words and very loudly, we could save the world, we could save all this. So that's the correct thing. But can we go for the reality audit once? In spite of having rule, in spite of having all the trade unions, central, number one, number two, we could not stop contractualization. We could not stop many, many, many. I'm not going to detail aspects of. So what is missing within ours? It is not one way, you are. Sometime it needs internal introspection also. Whether the existing practices of the trade union movement, and I used to say the traditional practices, traditional tools of the trade union movements, has lost the relevance, we need to find new tools to address ourselves. Many times it is coming whether there is unity or not. Of course, there is unity. There is no question of there is no unity at all. All the workers, organizations are together when it's a workers' concern. In coal industry, we all had been, we fought together. And very recently, it is ongoing. In defense, we are all together. Who says we are not together? For questions, I am inviting BMS or I am not inviting BMS. Where is workers' concern? I don't expect any invitation later. We are already there. But for the workers' concern, not for the labor politics. We would like to say we distinguish between the labor welfare and the labor politics. For the labor welfare, BMS is ready to finish its identity. But for the labor politics, we will not go even a single step towards. We are not for the politics. So, labor welfare is the core concern, and the labor welfare is the only area. And whenever, wherever labor's concerns are there, there is no issue. No one can say ki BMS is not there or C2 is not there. We all are there. And we are so friendly there. You can find even on these labor laws also. We have submitted class-wise our objections, reservation, whatever. We have given exhaustive. BMS has formed around a 35 persons, a group of this legal cell of within the organization. 30-35 people are working exhaustively on each and every rules and enactment. We have gone very jaunty, 2-3-4 sittings, then we came to a conclusion, then we came and submitted our objections, whatever, and wherever we are going, so no one should have any such impression in the mind that Indian trade unions are divided. Indian trade unions, workers' organizations are very well united. For the worker concerned, no one can break us, no one can. Telling it very loudly. No issue to understand that there is a division and anyone can divide us. Of course, we are a different organization with the different concepts, with the different ideology that are there. That's why BMS, Intex, C2, it is going to remain there. But we are working on the same domain, same area, same concern. So no question that we are working, moving separately. So the third bold, this one is the internal introspection within the trade union movement is most required. And the fourth one, that too also, BMS has put a proposal within the central trade union, all central trade union groups, can we have a intellectual backup for us. Then one of our friends said, "Bhai, it is costing very much. A huge cost is involved." Then we said, jointly, we are 10, 15, 10, 12 organizations. Can we jointly not afford it? Then we said, yes, of course. So can we all put together, cannot have a intellectual backup for us? The issue came when government is coming up with a draft. This is going to, this should be. Why not trade unions are coming? He suggested this should be. Then they said, from trade union sides, very exhaustive. We don't have that much intellectual backup. This is a lot of issues come. Then we came to say, BMS suggested, can we all together jointly, we can have our own intellectual backup group experts. We can hire it. Whatever cost involves, putting all 10, 12 central trade unions, we can afford the cost. There is no issue, we can do it. But that idea could not go further. So again, can we go to think all such things? The fight is very different. The entire discourse is completely changed. A digital push has taken space, acquired entire space. The trade union leadership, the cadre, entire setup needs to be reoriented, retrained into how to address all such aspects. So this aspect is also very important aspect. Trade unions should think. And again, BMS is open to have a joint get the assistance backup from for all sort of requirements within the trade union movement be required. So this is the basic, requirement looking to inside the trade unions, what weaknesses we have, how to overcome and how to address. Can by our own organization something we have to do, we can do within our own something we have to do, we can do jointly putting our efforts together. And the last one is trade unions have never been on the mercy of the government. In no time, never in the past, in the history, trade unions have never, because government has assisted, given some benefit they had. Trade union emergencies because of their resistance, their power of resistance, their strength of resistance. So we know we are not dependent on mercy of any of the government. And in no time, I have completed 40 years in the trade union movement. I have not seen any trade strike have been declared legal. So who is betting for you? You allow us or not? If I have power, if I have strength, if we are this much strengthened enough, who cares you? So the basic fundamental exists within the trade union movements. What we can do that needs to be addressed first. If we can get prepared ourselves, future of the Indian workers, future of the labor movement, many academics are coming back. Trade unions are declining. Who told you it is declining? It is your book assessment. Come on the ground. How you come to conclude it is declining movement? No. It is divided. Many researchers are coming to me. Wow. It is a very fragmented. It is divided. Who told you? No, there are 10. Yes, of course. We are born separately, but we are working jointly. We may have been different colors of flags, ideals, whatever it is. But the ultimate object of all the central trade unions, it is the same. So why you are looking, the glass is half empty. Why not you see my glass is half full? Same with the positivity, the future, the fate of Indian workers, Indian trade union movement is bright in my consensus, my conclusion. Little work is required to done. Something is within our soul, inside. Of course, we need to look. If anyone of from my friends say, I don't need to look our inside, I think something is missing. That should not be. We always need to look whether I'm okay, whether I'm ready, whether I'm prepared, whether I have got that much sufficient. Then after getting all preparedness, move out. Outside, we all are together. And together, we can fight anyone. Anyone. We have fought with the foreign imperialism, with the foreign institutes. These are our own government. We have placed them there. We can bring them down also. It is our might. We jointly can do. A lot of introspection is required within this movement, and we are lucky enough. Still, I find almost in all the central trade unions, at least at the upper level, still there are people of the greater understanding, deeper understanding, in spite of having all such. We do call each other every, when we are meeting, we are smiling, we are laughing. We are not enemies, yaar. We are a very close family persons. So with this, I think, in my opinion, a great and a very bright future is ahead. With some corrective measures, what is required within ours, we will do, and we will correct the entire discourse, what is get our needs corrected from outside. With this, I conclude. Thank you again, Brother Shyam Sundar ji and to all of you. Thank you, brother, very much.
Thank you, Mr. Upadhyay, for, there are three central arguments of yours. Number one, trade union is united. Number two, trade unions are not on the decline as academics would imagine. And number three, BMS, along with other trade unions, do not accept this as a labor code. This is a business code and not a labor code. But you made some three very important points, which I wish to highlight. Number one, you called for internal introspection within the trade union movement. You also noted that the traditional tools or methods used by the trade union movement need to be reviewed by the trade union movement. And of course, you also said that trade union movement must build its own intellectual resources or use the resources available in the larger society. And the fundamental point is that BMS, like other trade unions, are also opposed to the labor codes, and they do not approve of the labor codes in the way that they have been drafted. Thanks for providing these insights. And in any function, we keep the fireworks at the end. So I think now it's time to invite Comrade Amarjit Kaur, General Secretary, All India Trade Union Congress, for giving us the fireworks and the final observations, which could build on the earlier submissions and powerful observations made. Before I give the floor to her, we academics and journalists and all of us in the larger society want to affirm that we view trade unions as the vanguard of the working class, as the central powers of resistance and sorts of justice. This view will not be altered at any cost. We assure, I as a moderator, speaking on behalf of the larger society, assure. Over to you, Comrade Amarjit Kaur. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Chair of the webinar today, Father Fernandez. Moderator, Professor K.R. Shyam Sundar ji, my co-panelists and discussants, and all those who are participants, the audience, the researchers, all those who are interested, and all those who would like to do something for the labor. I have heard very keenly everybody, but first thing which I want to say, Shyam Sundar ji, I think we should accept, we have demanded these labor codes, we don't accept in this present form. We have already said that each labor code needs to be revisited and then only talk about rule framing. We have also said the government should not go ahead with it, not even on 1st October. It needs to be revisited. We have also said that Indian Labour Conference should look into this. It should pass through tripartism, which it has not done. And it has not passed the test of parliament also. It should pass the test of parliament, because in parliament, only ruling party was sitting, ministers and their MPs, whole of opposition was absent. So when Indian Labour Conference is not invited and no discussion happened, and Indian parliament, the highest seat of democracy, even their opposition was absent. So how can we accept these labour codes in present form? We may name it anything. We may name it a business code, as Brijesh is saying, or we may say it as an attitude of the government to do away with whatever better things are there in the world of labor. Everything is not good in the labor world, but whatever good was there, even that to be taken away. Now, your question, I begin with questions, then only all that what my friends have said, I will make little additions into that. Your question was that, of course, we supported the farmers' movement. You know, we asked for repeal of those three farm laws, as well as electricity bill amendment which government brought. Simultaneously, we said the labor codes should be withdrawn. We moved with a pace when farmers ultimately put into their demands and in their campaigns, at least. Demands, of course, are ours, but into their campaigns, they started telling that they are demanding repeal of farm laws. We, Kisan Morcha, will demand for repeal of four labor codes. So we proceeded up to that level. Second level where we could reach was that they said the corporates want to grab their lands, so we will not allow it. And our battle is not only our battle, it is for the stomach of all Indians. So Essential Commodities Act will go against all people of the country, including the labor. So our battle is not for farmers, our battle is for the whole nation. And we recognize what they said, because food security of about migrant workers, which we were talking a little bit, friends were talking about, they very much depend on vast majority of them on this whole issue of food security. So from that point of view, I would agree that we reached a little ahead, that we said government's eye is on the lands of public sector. And Kisans are saying government's eye is on the farmland. So we are opposing corporates taking over our public sector and government privatizing, and they are opposing and saying our land of farmers should not be taken away. The land is a state subject, and labor is also state subject. So the federal structure is also being put under stake. So this is my additional point. It's not only that the farmers are saying why the federal structure is not being respected by government of India. We, the trade unions, are also saying how you can try to impose without consulting state governments at the formulating stage itself. In the formulating stage itself, drafting stage itself, the trade unions, the governments, state governments, the employers, everybody needs to be taken on board. But nobody was taken on board except that the employers, their unilateral views were accepted by the government. But all three were not made to sit in the Indian Labour Congress. Now, having said that thing, I also want to say that it is true that we could not build up the movement as much it should have been. Let us accept this reality. If we accept this reality, then only we will be much more serious to develop our movements. I am not denying that we have conducted several strikes since neoliberal economy in 1991, when it was declared. We have passed through 7 strikes during Modiji's period also. So we have done the strikes, we have done big morchas, we did a 3 days continuous morcha at parliament, every day between 70,000 to 1 lakh people were there. We did that also, and we did All India campaigns also. We succeeded in having strike during COVID on 26 November in 2020. But the way the attack is it sufficient? If you look at that, then Professor Shyam Sundar, I look into the point which you are making. It is bigger movements, larger movements, consolidated movements, expanding movements, substantiated movements are needed because attacks are too big. Farmers, succeeded in taking their points in simple language to every farm household, including we succeeded in telling our workers what does it mean when these farm laws which are converted into act, what will it mean for the common people and the workers. But let me tell you, this is true, that we have not succeeded till date about four codes and their dangers to be taken to the large masses, our own workers' families. We are addressing our constituencies, our workers, of course, our unions, and now we are telling them to take it to the families also. But the way farm laws reach the common people, these codes are such a serious issue for the workers of India. We could not create that impression among other sections of the society, including our vast majority of informal workers, unorganized sector workers. So the fire will happen if everybody understands how dangerous these four codes are, what will be implication to their lives. So we need to have a strenuous campaign. You are asking what should be the strategy of trade unions. Of course we should have unity. Of course we should build unity with farmers. Of course, we should have unity beyond workers and farmers. Of course, we need the people to understand we need to have a strenuous campaign on these dangers which these labor codes are going to put. Now, until and unless that understanding of the scale is there, the movement will not be strong. And that's where why I want to say, when even the unions were not born and there were strikes happening in India, and today all my friends talked about how strike itself is being put on hold. You won't be able to hold strike if we allow all these codes to be implemented, IR code to be implemented, or EDSO, which is under debate inside the parliament now, if that is implemented. So strikes were happening in 19th century itself, from 1827 onwards. And I also want to tell, the Royal Commission, which was set up by the Britishers, had also to say that you cannot degrade workers. You cannot degrade the poor people who are laboring. No, if a colonial master believes and says, maybe there was compulsions with them, the debates which were happening in Britannia, maybe that was the compulsion with them for their own businesses. But they did say that Royal Commission talked about it. If the Royal Commission talks about that, where are we today in 2021? All these labor codes and the rules, if implemented, will snatch away the dignity of workers, for which even colonial masters, Royal Commission talked about. And we have reached a stage where we say the labor laws are human rights. And if we are talking of human rights discourse, then can we say it is a non-political issue? I would say the beauty is that we trade unions have understand the things, but then we have different ways of dealing. We have different perceptions. We have different viewpoints. And that is the beauty of India, that pluralism, diverse opinions, dissenting opinions, total freedom of expression. And with all those differences, you can also move together on certain issues. And that beauty we get from our constitution. And let me assert, this attack on the workers through these labor codes and these rule framing is on the constitutional morality. This is attack on our constitutional morality. I would also say it is attack on our constitutional ethos, constitutional values. Why I'm saying it? Until and unless we have that anguish in our hearts, we will not be able to fight. And that anguish has to be understood by our workers. And I want to say, to define that labor welfare is something and labor politics is something, Brijesh ji has his own opinion. I respect his opinion, but that is his opinion. We look at this situation in a different way. We say Indian working class fought for India's independence. And Indian working class was very much doing politics for freeing our country from colonial masters. But Indian working class knew that they are not political parties. Whenever they wanted political discourse to come, they went to political parties and put forth their demand charter before them. They did not assume the role of political parties ever. So there were unions and unions in the formal and informal sector from 19th century last part, from 20th century from the beginning. And then in 1920, first trade union center, AITUC, was formed, which is known as a mother trade union. So formal, informal sector unions were there. And let me tell you, when that AITUC was being formed, great freedom fighters were part of it, supporting it and even assuming some offices into it. Labor movement was supporting the freedom movement and the freedom movement was supportive of the labor movement. So there was a division. Political parties were different. Working class movement was different, but the working class had its politics. So labor always had politics. Labor did not talk only about welfare. We talk in terms of rights, our working hours, from where it will come, from the policy of the government. We talked about our wages. Who will decide wages? Wages will come from the policy of the government. We said workplace safety is required and compensation is needed to be given. What was it? It was a politics. Then if we say that our unionization should be legalized, we are asking legal. So we got legalized in 1926 when we got the Trade Union Act 1926. So all those laws which we got pre-independence era and then in post-independence era, all those laws come from the policies of the government. So if the policies of the government can help and bring in a better life for the working masses of the country, but the policies of the government can ruin the lives of the working classes and the working masses of the country. Policies of the government can bring in better revenues as through government employees, through the public sector employees, all the better life, those who are enjoying the fruits of labor laws and the social security from the parliament and from various legislations, where a vast majority of our unorganized sector workforce is left out, which even Brijesh ji accepted it. All trade unions accepted that vast majority of workforce is out of the purview of present labor legislations. But if the present day government wants to throw out even those who are protected, most of them to be excluded from there. So if their policies are harming us, to challenge those policies is labor politics. It is not labor welfare. It is labor politics. And that is where I want to assert. So the very first trade union, which was founded in India as a national center, the trade unions were founded from end of 19th century onward. So all those who had formed unions came to Bombay, conference was held. Great Lala Lajpat Rai, who faced lathis from Simon Commission, he was the first founding president. Now there I want to say, one thing was said very clearly. We will move ahead trade unions free of governments, trade unions free of managements, trade unions free of political parties. And let me emphasize, AITUC continues with that principle. All those people who may be members or leaders at different levels can have their political opinions and work in any political party, go and contest elections. But AITUC is free of political parties. We will take our decisions as the IGUC. That is the line which first Indian trade union founded as a national center had given. So there, my friends, I want to come to the our strategies. And before coming to those strategies, I want to say our collective wisdom today comes from beginning from Royal Commission to the struggles in India pre-independence, then to our first labor commission, then we get the second labor commission also, then the parliaments, the legislations have worked, movements, agitations have worked. It is all plethora of functioning and activity at the policy making, at the implementation level, and at the agitational level, which has collectively given us the present day labor legislations which we had. And that is being challenged. It is not only a few trade unions named like recognition and you are quarreling with them that you are bringing in labor codes and they are opposing. Our whole history is being challenged by these labor codes. And that's why we have to fight back. And that fighting back cannot be through words. It has to be through movements. And those movements to have larger participations. This forming of these labor rights included ILO contribution also. It included international conventions, international labor standards. All that comes collectively, and then we got these rights. I want to assert here, and that's why I said whatever we got from constitution, even that is under attack. That's why I say constitutional morality and constitutional values are also under attack. And I also say Article 19 of Fundamental Rights is under attack through these labor codes. Are we going to allow? Right to assembly. All my friends explained that unionization will be weakened. Strikes will happen. Derecognition will be made. Because even if you make law, you will not be able to stop these strikes. People in distress will go ahead for strikes. If you deny them job security, if you deny them wages, if you deny them minimum basic needs which they want to have, and you force them for more working hours, despite the law that you will not allow strike, there will be strikes, as we say, wildcat strikes. You see, there were areas where strike notices required, there were areas where strike notices were not required. But there were wildcat strikes happening, and nobody will be able to stop those wildcat strikes, I want to tell. So it is not bringing peace in industrial zones or in the workplaces. It is actually labor codes will be destroying the whole system of conciliation and adjudication, will be destroying the peaceful ways of agitations of workers, will be destroying the organized peaceful method of strikes being conducted in India. So in a way, that danger is there, which workers have to realize if they have to be on the streets. And that not only workers and employees, other sections of the society who are benefited with the labor of work and the services of work. So this is how I look at. And that's why I would say that all these labor laws are actually strike and lockouts were at par. I am making additional points now. Strikes and lockouts were at par. Now, total bias in favor of employers. Also, I will say that this bias in favor of management and illegality of strike, which will begin with the strike notice itself, will invite derecognition. So collective bargaining is under attack. And India is signatory to collective bargaining internationally. And we have ratified the ILO convention also. And this public utility, non-public unity, that division was there. That division is finished. That is the danger. Then reference is totally going away. That's why from the notice, conciliation begins and the strike is illegal. So, my friends, the government is entering into a dangerous zone, is creating conflicts, will bring in restlessness into the industrial areas. What is the path left with us? We will go into agitation. We will ask the workers not to follow more than 8 hours if you are not given overtime. If you are not covered under occupational safety health, you have to demand and fight for that. We have to fight for social security coverage for all those who are left out, or all those who are being excluded. We have right for picketing in India. But this picketing right is also going away with EDSO and with these courts. Right to picketing. How Supreme Court reacted to when some people went to Supreme Court that removed these farmers from here. Why they are picketing on roads? Supreme Court said we cannot stop peaceful picketing. This right was with us, which is being taken away by these labor courts and by the rules. Rules are further damaging than the courts. As Shyam Sundar ji said, we are not to go into details. I'm not going, I'm saying only the over thing. So coverage will shrink through these things. There in the wage code on minimum wage act or the payment of wages act will be made redundant. It will be difficult thing to address whole vast majority of informal economy workers to get them wages. And the government wants to make minimum wage and floor level wage as if it is one or the same thing. Minimum wage is minimum wage. All those who are covered under schedule will get it. All those who are not covered under schedule, then you can talk in terms of floor level wage that below this, nobody will give anybody. But that doesn't mean that those minimum wage people who are covered will be removed from there and minimum wages. That is why government wants to remove these minimum wages, the present context, so that the everybody could be brought down to rupees 178 per day, as a minister announced in the parliament. That's why, my friends, I want to say there were 2,000 occupations were there in the scheduled employment. Government has done away with that schedule. And now this wage question itself will be a difficult thing, because notification of schedule used to happen, discussion used to happen, then the minimum wages used to be announced, notified, and then the things could go ahead, then the trade unions could play their role. Now all that role will go away. And that's why I think 15th Indian Labour Conference is disrespected, and now ILC not happening for last 6 years is another insult to Indians. It is insult to Indians, I say, to our constitution. You commit in the international fora and you fail to implement it. You take the oath of constitution and sit in the seat of power, and then you disrespect what comes out of Indian Labour Conference and what constitution demands us to do. And that's why I think government is far away from the slogan of ILO of giving decent wage. Our constitution talked of living wage, but we did not have that. Then the Fair Wage Commission was set up, but that recommendations were never implemented in India. We are left with minimum wage, and this government wants to do away with that minimum wage concept also. Comrade. And it's defining also. I would like to come to closing. I know the times are is happening. And that's why I would say that this wage issue also is quite serious with us. We have talked other times also. Now, Social Security Code also is exclusive. Some friends have talked about it. It used to have 9 points by ILO for every country as a standard measure. And India was fulfilling those 9 points in social security, even though that social security coverage is only 5 to 6% population of the workforce, not others. So the idea was to bring everybody in this side. Instead of that, those who are covered, they are being endangered. Their social security will get snatched away and weakened. And then if you talk about all these, I leave the occupational safety health. During this period, we saw so many accidents happening during the opening up. Occupational safety health issue is life and death question for workers. But OSH has removed interstate migrant act has been abolished.
Interstate Migrant Act had 26 clauses. And this government has taken out 6 clauses out of that and put in this code. Let me tell you, and they have no meaning. Are they serious about those migrant workers who suffered? Crores of them, and are today also suffering. Many of them did not get jobs, are not able to come back, and women have suffered worst in that because their drop out of jobs is much more than men, and their joining back is less, much less than the men. This all has happened. So lastly, I come to the questions which you raised there. One is that we don't accept these labor codes. These are insult to Indian labor and to Indian constitution and to international commitments which India has made. So where to go? That means the rules should not be accepted. Number three, state governments, we are appealing as trade unions. We are telling them, don't go with the rules. And that is wherever discussions are happening. This is true, all my friends told that we are submitting our amendments because we don't go out of the discourse. We are asking for social dialogue. We are asking for ILC. We want dialogues. That is why whatever government is putting on web page, we are definitely replying that and telling them and again repeating, we don't accept these labor codes. So we are into that process, not because we have accepted that labor codes. We don't accept it. This we repeat every time we say conduct discussions on each labor code. So that is another thing. Then rules, comments we'll make, I have already told you, rules are much more damaging even than the codes. If you ask me what dialogues are happening both at central and state level, at central level, dialogue is missing. It is totally missing. Calling through webinar for a few minutes and saying we are consulting, you will have no meaning. These codes are huge. 400 pages, 300 pages, 250 pages, 700 pages. It's a mockery which they are saying we will be consulting, but no, nothing is happening. In the states also, the things are not good. No consultations properly. A few states did call them for this rule framing and they asked us and we told our state chapters what we have submitted. We send it to you, but in your state specifically, you can add and put it there. So there also trade unions are making submissions, but trade unions are saying we don't accept these labor codes. So do not implement these.
We are going out of the, it's 8:30, please.
Yeah. So so the state levels, also, we are agitating, and the central level also we are agitating, and we have announced 9th August to be observed. Recently, we conducted several campaigns. Now we are busy with, as I told you, we have to carry the things to our workers, to their families and the masses. So our extensive campaign all over India has begun to explain about codes and rules, to explain about attack on farmers, and then against privatization of public sector. All those issues we are taking up, asking for a migrant act also, asking for policy for them, asking for 7,500 cash to the families, asking for universal coverage for public distribution system. Several of the demands are there. We are campaigning. 9th August will be observed as Save India Day. On all these questions, asking for repeal of these laws and saving our public sector and attacking these attacks through EDSO, we are opposing that also. So we will be on warpath. I want to tell you, it's not only 9th August campaign. We are visualizing in future. We will definitely try to have a multi-days strike. Sector-wise, one-day, two-day strikes may happen, but we will go ahead for our national general strike. We have been going on for 1 day, 2 days, but this time when we go on indefinite strike or multi-days strike, that time will tell, but we will begin with multi-days strike and then we will see how the situations grow in the country as far as mobilization is concerned. And I want to tell you various sectoral strikes are going to happen. That is on the path. Insurance sector has already announced, I think tomorrow they are going on strike. And similarly, defense is still planning despite EDSO. They are still planning. Banks were planning, and now finance minister says that those two banks which they were to privatize, they have been postponed to defer to 2021. So maybe immediate strike may not happen. They will go for campaign mode. So campaign, agitation, and then for multi-day strike, that will be modus operandi. We will go ahead sectorally. Sometimes we are coming together, as Vrijesh ji said, in defense we were together, in coal we were together. We will be very happy if BMS is part of that joint platform of central trade unions once again. I would definitely say, but not only for welfare measures, but for labor politics. And labor politics is not political party politics. It is a working class who no produces wealth.
No, okay, politics. thank you comrade. No, thank you sir. It has been a pleasure listening to comrade Amarjit Kaur. She made a very organized, lively, infused and absolutely standout performance in terms of articulating the trade union perspective, the strategy. But I just want to highlight two points before I request the discussants to come in. She made a very fundamental observation. The entire architecture of labor rights, even the labor movement, the labor history is being challenged by the labor codes. This is the most powerful observation I have ever come across. And of course, I thank her for confessing that the trade union movement need to scale up its agitations. And she also made a point that labor politics and labor welfare cannot be disentangled. They stand together. I leave it to the sensitivity and the intelligence of the listeners about the kind of differences of opinion that could be there. Now, I just want to ask the discussants, and of course, she had mapped out the strategy, saying that there'll be sectoral strikes. There'll be multi-day strikes, not one day, 2 days, and there'll be indefinite strike. So we get a sense, on the one hand, the trade union movement is knocking at the doors of the government for social dialogue and a relook at the parliament, revisiting of the entire labor codes, or there could be some kind of agitations, there could be mass agitations. And of course, he had also made a point that there is an alliance between the peasants and the industrial working class. The point is well taken. The point that I want the discussants to ask, particularly I want Professor Rashmi Venkatesan to say, is there any chance that the parliament constitutionally can have a relook at the once passed labor codes if the trade union movement makes a mass movement, making a demand on the part of the government? And to Mr. Prashant Ananda, what is the pulse of the society you are interacting with most stakeholders? So with these comments and observations, I will leave my role as a moderator temporarily. And I will request Professor Rashmi Venkatesan to come on board to share her views and perspectives. Thank you very much. It has been a pleasure listening to the stalwarts of the trade union movement. Over to you, Professor Rashmi.
Thank you, Professor Samsundar. Okay, that's a quick question, so I don't know how much I'll be able to really give you an in-depth response. But it was really a pleasure listening to all the luminaries of the trade union movement for the last almost 2 hours. And I think that is, it's fair to say that there is consensus that the labor code is problematic, which would be resisted by the workers of all the trade unions. And I think most of the academics and labor activists are on board with that as well. When I first read about, two quick things in the beginning. One, I'm not a labor law professor. I teach human rights and I teach law and development. And which is why I think it's very interesting that labor law sits exactly in the intersection of these two things. And that's why it's relevant for me. That's how I got into this idea, you know, got into the development discourse, because I came from a bit of a labor background in my earlier working life. And it's interesting that that perspective, that labor law and labor rights and labor justice sits exactly at where law, social justice, constitutional morality, development sit, is somewhere seems to be missing out on in the public perception. So probably I would weave into the answer to your question, Professor Shyamsundar, it also the broader point that I wanted to make, listening to everybody in this panel, and also when I was reflecting on you know, what I would be thinking about when I first heard of the webinar. And it was quite interesting that when we think about labor law, and this is something that Professor, you have written about, and I've also sort of briefly done so, is that we think about it in either the question of as a labor issue or as a legal issue. And it, the major writings around this have come from that position of, you know, looking at labor code as either a labor issue or as a legal issue. Now, of course, it is both. It is a labor issue and it is a legal issue as well. But it is not just a labor issue and it is not just a legal issue. Mm-hmm. And that is something that I think most panelists here would definitely agree upon. And when we talk, and the reason is that because when we talk about labor issue, it's and I speak as somebody who addresses a very young audience on a regular basis, I'm sure as you would too. Labor is considered to be a very specific interest group that you can pick and choose about who comes under this term labor, comes under this term working class, and that labor laws are only meant for those people or only meant for a certain community or only meant for a certain section. We don't think about labor in its larger context and its larger, longer political history, as Madam Avijit Kaur was talking about, or in its particular relevance today as being the vanguard of social and economic justice. So thinking about labor codes and how do we pitch labor codes, both as an issue of constitutional morality and constitutional imagination, perhaps, but also as a vision of constructing a fair society, we don't think about labor as a, you know, as a top of the list sort of a thing that we need to work on. So when the public perception around labor codes, in my view, has been one of the probably where a lot of the conversation and a lot of the introspection also needs to be done. I obviously don't speak as a labor unionist because I'm not, and I don't represent any trade union. I'm not a part of, you know, obviously not building a strategy, but as a citizen who is, you know, engaged with labor issues, and also as an academic who's interested in labor issues, as being a part of a larger developmental and economic reforms issue. And in that context, that intersectionality or that placing of labor codes is somewhere I think missing. And I think my next discussant can also discuss that in a little bit more depth when you asked how does the larger society view it. I'm interested in that perception, what Father Fernandez left us with in the beginning, saying it is a polarized perspective. And the intervention, the place where I think more of the conversation needs to be done is on how do we build that perspective and how do we build that narrative, the public narrative around it. Because there is a fair amount of writing, there is a fair amount of consensus, there is a whole lot of critique on what is wrong with the labor codes. There is, you have written on that extensively, other labor scholars have written on that extensively, and this conversation has been going on for so long. Almost, it goes back to decades when labor scholars have been critiquing what is, you know, what is the structure of labor laws in general, why the 1991 reforms have been chipping away at labor laws steadily, a little bit in each state, you know, from here and from there, without necessarily making it look like a full-blown assault on labor per se. So these things have been written about for a long time. And, you know, the labor codes is not going to be, it's not the end of the conversation. It's a part of the journey. There are going to be even more relaxations on labor protections. Whatever rules we make now are probably going to get even more relaxed in favor of business. So this is just one big milestone in that long journey of, you know, deregulating, in quotes, deregulating labor in favor of, you know, having more control of businesses. The point that I'm trying to make is that the intellectual work behind the critique of labor law is not missing. It is alive, it is thriving, it is out there for everyone to see. The translation of that from a understanding within the specific domains of either labor and law to a larger public discourse, I think there has been a bit of a disconnect. And what makes me say that is because if we look at something that happened like the farmers' resistance, the farm laws that came about, it happened on the heels of the labor code. In fact, the labor code had a much longer history of critique than the farm laws. But the farm laws was able to generate a kind of public discourse that I thought the labor codes were not in a position to do. And that's probably also goes back to our ideas of introspection. You know, why is this translation of a labor code or resisting a labor code or articulating what is a critique of the labor code is also a critique of economic morality, of economic and political justice, of where development, what we mean of that is going today. And that labor is not something that is restricted to a few people. Just like the farmers' agitation was, it really captured the public imagination. It was people, public intellectuals were speaking about it, students were talking about it. It was all over the social media. So it became the translation from labor to public, like the way the farmers to public happened. I think that is something that we really need to think about more carefully about why is that missing? Why is it that a labor issue is considered to be, or a labor law issue is considered to be just a labor issue, meaning that only trade unions can speak about it. It concerns only people who are a part of the trade union. And it does not become a question of a public morality. It doesn't become a question. It's not considered to be a public issue. And there is a lot to be said about that, because if we really think about what labor laws do, and is that they really sit at the center of economic justice. What we are really talking about here when we talk about the dismantling of labor codes, and as my other panelists were talking about, that this is an assault on what the constitutional imagination is. This is an assault on what, this is a negation of what the labor history has been for so long of securing rights little bit over a period of time through struggle and agitation and mobilization. That what we're really talking about is a larger economic system that is now headed towards concentrating economic and social power to a very, very few people, which is going to be the employers and the state in nexus with each other. And the large majority of us is going to be left out. So the dismantling of labor laws and labor protection is not an issue of just either law or labor, that it is a public issue and that it has to be articulated as such. We need to find intellectuals, we need to find writings, we need to be in the public forum as not something that, you know, that you need to support us because we, in quotes, are a very specific entity, but that this concerns a much larger issue of developmental morality, of economic justice. That, I think, is that discourse and that narrative somewhere, at least from my readings, has not been very clear. It has largely been restricted to a critique of the laws, of what was earlier, what will become now, and why that is dangerous. But the danger is far more amplified than just being restricted to people who are, you know, workers who are a part of the trade union or workers in general. So I think that that translation from labor to public and from a labor law perspective to a public discourse perspective needs to be done much more carefully. Along with that, I think something that everyone else raised, which was on the strategies and introspecting on the strategies of the trade union, I wonder if there is a way to make it more young, in the sense of on getting on the digital platforms, getting on different medias. This is where we're all getting our information from. And I'm sure this is something that trade unions have been exploring, but we really need to message in a way that the message is being heard and listened to and engaged with by a lot of young people and a lot of people who don't consider themselves necessarily as natural allies of labor or don't consider them as part of their public politics. So there is, I think, how does that happen is something that is as a reader or a consumer of news, is something that I think is relevant because you see some things that get captured very easily under the public imagination and some don't. And I think labor tends to lag behind as not being an issue that concerns everyone or that is, it doesn't stream on your social media page, for instance, almost ever. And that's what creates news, right? There are no Twitter storms on labor codes. There are no, my Facebook hardly talks about, when the farm protest was happening, you could not see your Facebook page without at least somebody posting a meme around it. But it's so easy for labor courts to just slip under the radar, which is extremely problematic. And, you know, it has implications, obviously, that, I won't take too much time. In terms of the law, they say law is an ass, it bites you if it's in front of you and kicks you if you're behind it. That's also true for labor, because I think the legal history of the labor laws have also been very problematic. The so-called industrial peace is really a compromise between how to get industrial production going along with also keeping labor happy. The question of the constitution, I think, is a little bit more complicated than that. Over the top of my head, I'm not really sure how much a constitutional challenge will do, because we've also seen how the judiciary has moved in its constitutional interpretation over the last 30 so years. And if we really think about the idea that a lot of national security laws are still considered to be constitutional, the labor courts will most likely, my reading is that they're not going to be struck down as unconstitutional. That seems extremely, extremely unlikely. Because as I said, there have been so many other labor laws and labor courts, and this is going to be considered parliamentary prerogative. There is nothing overly on top of it that is, you know, constitutional morality is an evolving concept. It does not really, you can't say this is against constitutional morality and get it thrown out as unconstitutional. So I'm not really sure how that's going to go. However, linking back to what I was saying earlier, a public discourse around it also does have an impact on how the judicial response for this is going to be and how the parliamentary response is going to be. The kind of steps that can be taken with the impunity that it gets taken with perhaps can be resisted or reined in a bit with if you have a much robust public discourse around what labor codes are set to do or are going to end up doing in the next few months, God. To turn out. That was my big point. How do we translate this entire knowledge and critique that we have into a course that talks about labor in the context of a public generation of discourse? Second, I think there's been a lot of conversation around trade union rights, but we need to have a lot more on occupational health and safety and social security laws. That's something also that I think needs particular attention by trade unions to look at. Before Professor tells me that my time is over, I think that's where I'll stop. But thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Rashmi Venkatesan. The point that you made is how do we build up a public narrative around the labor codes, or how do we wed or strike a fruitful, productive marriage between the public narrative and the labor movement? Given that this is only the one signpost of dilution of labor rights, there may be more that would be coming in the days to come, like the Essential Services Defense Bill, Ordinance and Bill, etc. So you made a very important point that the farmers' agitation achieved a sense of public and political legitimacy. On the other hand, we have an entrenched historic labor laws and legal framework, and we have a tripartite framework, and we have International Labor Organization. We have such a huge architecture, yet trade unions have not been able to, what you said, as create a connect between labor and public. That kind of articulation is missing. So that the labor course has not caught on to the public imagination. And of course, you said that trade unions should learn to grow young. This is something that the trade union leaders must ponder about, which many of my students do ask. With due respect and apology to all the veterans, why do they stay on, linger on? This is something the trade union movement needs to ponder on. We are outsiders and they are insiders. They need to talk about it. And now I will request Prasanthananda, who has been listening patiently. And of course, he's a journalist. He's used to listen, waiting and listening to people. Sir, over to you.
Good evening. Should I say good night? I don't know. See, before I start, I must say, if we are not focused, we will lose the track. And the proof of this is from 48 participants, we are down to 32 in 30 minutes. That clearly shows that we are slowly not perhaps focusing as much as we should focus on the issue. Okay. Second point is, as a discussant, I'm a journalist. I'll come to that, that public perception point that Professor Shyamasundar asked. As a discussant, generally, I believe that in an academic discussion or in a good discussion, you get the papers well in advance, you read them, then you take the discussion forward. But in a discussion like this, it is everything is impromptu. So I'm just taking 3-4 points of what the speaker said as a microcosm of the public perception. Now we have lost one more. So I'll just be short in 5 minutes. Dr. Fernandez touched upon the bipolar views, the complete contrast of East and West between what the industry and the government thinks and what the trade unions thinks. What he didn't say is what the public and the working class think. So here is the disconnect between the trade union, the public view, and the labor market in total. So labor market has to be part of this trade union thought process. We cannot look at trade unions as a group of people who only complain. We have to look at them as catalyst, and they have to improve. Perhaps there, I don't know, there are so many veterans here, they have seen much more life than me, but I think this is one suggestion. The second point, I think Chandra Prakash ji said very interesting point, and that also talks about the frustration of the trade unions. That सरकार तो हमारी बात सुनेगी नहीं, हमें पता है नहीं सुनेगी, यही perception है public में भी कि trade union की बात सरकार नहीं सुनेगी, whether it is labor courts or anything else, but क्यों नहीं सुनेगी, whether it is a Congress government, whether it is a non-Congress government, or whether it is a BJP government or NDA government, because what Brijesh ji pointed out, it lacks an intellectual backbone. We speak more out of emotions and lack the heft, the data to speak about what we are speaking. For example, why can't the trade unions during the negotiation with the government and labor courts suggest what should be the percentage of fund that the government must collect from the gig and platform companies for their social welfare? The government was decided 2%, and 2% has as a two different connotations, whether it is 2% of revenue or 2% of the salary paid. So it's still not sure about that. Most probably it is 2% of the salary paid that the ministry has come down to. So why we can't come to this point to suggest concrete points? So this is where we are missing. Amitabh Guha Saab said, hum celebrity nahi, hum to audio mein baat kar sakte hain. And here Professor Venkateshan said, perhaps answer that question in a different way. Let me put it together. Because you are missing from public perception and public view. If you are not ready to be seen, how can somebody will talk about you? Don't take me, I'm only 42 year old. Most of you I'm 17 years in this profession. First, why don't you want to be seen? Why don't you want to be taken seriously? Okay, so what is the set the professor, and now the professor asked me, what is the public perception? Let me ask, I think I jot down a few points. This labor code is being discussed from 2014. The Rajasthan government took the lead first, and the other states followed. The top bureaucrats wrote to states saying follow the Rajasthan model, and slowly the labor codes evolve in the national level. I just want to understand why they didn't convince, if the industry can convince the government that this is not good for industry, why we fail to convince the government that this is bad for the people? It is because what Brijesh ji said, there is still a disconnect between labor welfare and labor politics. This is where we need to walk on very, very seriously, whether we accept it or not. And if Brijesh ji said strength of resistance, we all accept it. I think Professor Shyamasundar has already said that everybody accepts what the trade unions do for the working class, especially a small portion of working class. Let me rephrase that. But boss, you are fading. Let's accept it. You are fading in public perception. We are not growing young. We are still, these are shortcomings. We have to, if I don't have a job, then I will search for a job. I will not sit down at my home and cry. So where is the job search? Where is the introspection? Where we are going? This is one point. Second point is, see, we are in 2020. What is, why the trade union movement grew and on which footing it grew? Let's accept two things. It grew on the strength of PSUs and PSU staff. What does the PSUs, government companies, state-run companies, staff has that we do not have right now? It is a job security, a decent job. We do not have a decent job. Our basic salary is 6,000 rupees, 8,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees, 15,000 rupees. Look at the payroll data of EPFO. Majority, two-thirds of them are earning less than 15,000 rupees. We are representing that class. So how can we expect, unless we evolve, that our trade union movement will sustain for next 20 years, 30 years? I think I wrote a story. I spoke to Amarjit ma'am, and they turned 100. At 101, we are struggling. We are not experienced. So we have not changed. We have become static. So this is where we need to go. When I say we, it is the trade unions. I'm always a third party. It's a go between the government and the public. Especially I'm a public perception person. I'm a person who writes about the people's view. And the most important point is, let me give you a few data points, two, three data points before I end my conversation and give my last. Payroll data, we are all talking about. Some of these panelists here are part of the EPFO system. If you look at the payroll system, 55 to 60% of the jobs being created every month are coming from expert services. I spoke with Professor Shamsundar the other day. Who are these expert services? They're staffing companies, petty contractors, and the security guards. And then with these kind of people, what the trade unions are doing? And second, are they looking at a much bigger, larger picture? And okay, this is one part. Look at the CMI data. CMI data of July end. We are on August 3rd. I'm talking about a data which is two days old. We have a 400 million labor market. And we have only 76 million salaried people. So trade unions are at max talking about 76 million people. And they're not talking about the larger informal sector. And 2019 paper of ILO very clearly says, the survival and the growth of trade union will depend on how they represent the informal sectors. And we cannot deny that fact that without representing the informal sector, and more so in 2021, when fixed term employment is now illegal across sectors and gig work is taking away the permanent and regular works. So are we representing gig workers? Are we representing fixed-term workers? Or are we only talking from some industrial belts? As such, we do not have a presence in the IT, ITA sector. The EdTech sector is growing faster. E-commerce sector is growing faster. Are we even present there? How will we represent them? So these are the areas that perhaps we are missing very, very clearly and getting very emotional on certain things. For me to tell you that listen to me will depend on what I am saying. And if the audience is not my friend and it is a public, it is a very heterogeneous group, then I need to be very focused to the point and tell them, boss, what I am telling you makes sense for your well-being. And before I end, everybody is talking about the farmers movement and the trade union movement, why it is not as effective. I think Dr. Rashmi Venkatesan touched upon that. This is a very socio-economic issue, I think. Farmers who are protesting are rich. Laborers who are protesting are poor. They cannot protest for 10 days at a strength because that will impact their family livelihood. In contrast, the farmers who are protesting are fairly rich. They are replenishing each other, going back and coming back. So we have to accept that it's a reality that our labor class is poor. as trade unions, are we helping them get a job? Are we helping them negotiate the salary? The labor codes has actually made life difficult for trade unions in terms of going to a negotiation table, in terms of holding protest, in terms of whether the outside labor union leaders have a role in the inside negotiation table. And second, let me also warn you a very interesting point. In a negotiating table, if a trade union has only 51% staff strength, then it will be the sole negotiating person. And let me tell you, once these codes are implemented, you will see your friendly trade union will poach into your own trade union people just to be the sole negotiating agent, because it helps them. The labor politics comes in then. We have seen enough examples, including the Maruti. So my point is, and we all, this is not Prashant Nanda's view. This is the view of the public. This is how we look at them. We look at them, and what the trade unions, especially across board, across color, should do is they must move. Of course, the resistance fact is very important, but from banner and shouting, they need to become intellectuals, young, appealing, and forceful in their view as solution providers, not just problem. Because industries and government always tell that trade unions are militant trade unions. We don't want to hear that. Thank you so much for your time, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, President Nanda, for making very powerful points. I'll just summarize before the number gets from 19 to 18 to 15. Number one is that as a person who interacts with the society, you say that there is a growing disconnect between trade unions and the public. So the point that Dr. Professor Ashmi Venkatesan said, and you said, in a sense, gel. She said there is a need to build a public narrative. And you said that there is a disconnect between public and trade unions. Both of you have sounded cautionary notes. And if I can expand what Professor Ashmi Venkatesan said and weld into what you said, trade unions should not only grow young, but they should evolve and they should change and they should become representative. You have given two interesting points. On the one hand, there is a traditional informal sector which is underrepresented by the trade unions or underrepresented by the trade unions. On the other hand, from the payroll data, you said that a new labor market is emerging. So these are very interesting insights. So The larger point that is coming across is that the discussions are saying that the trade unions need to introspect, need to change, need to refocus, need to retool, as they themselves have recognized and several panelists have spoken, and they need to build a public narrative to reach out to the larger masses and be representative in a sense. I think there could not have been a wonderful panel discussion such as this. Comrade Amitav Guga and Mr. Chandraprakash Singh provided a wonderful critique, and Mr. Vrijesh Upadhyaya and Comrade Amarjit Kaur built on, though in a diverse sense, their own perceptions, their own perspectives on the path ahead. I think, and the discussions have added meat and said that, look, you need to stay relevant, you need to stay young, and you need to build your legitimacy. I think this is one of the wonderful panel discussions I have ever been involved as a moderator, of course, to have time management and trade union leaders. It is very difficult. And we need to concede that. But I think the panel discussion has come out with wonderful ideas. And I do not know whether we have time to have another round of discussion, to way forward. But I'll just make one last comment and I would stop and give the floor to Father Denzel Fernandez. That there is no doubt that the trade union movement has earned its legitimacy within the working class and to the academics, but it needs to perhaps reinvent itself in the era of globalization with the digitalization, modernization, and various other challenges that are approaching. But I'm sure, I want to end on a note of optimism that trade unions have seen the end of colonial imperialism. They will see the end of this kind of modern imperialism. I'm sure only the question is how. And it is for them to introspect. Thank you very much, all four panelists and the two discussants, for an extremely interesting and very engaging time and ideas. I thank Dr. Arjun Kumar for this, and I hand over the proceedings to Father Denzel Fernandez. Thank you once again to all of you.
Thank you very much, Professor Shyam Sundar, and all the panelists, especially the trade union leaders, for presenting the trade union perspective, and the discussants for such valuable comments. It's already very late, so I don't want to say much, but just a couple of points I would like to make. The first thing is that there is unanimity that there are serious problems with the labor codes, and all codes, there's of course calls to repeal it and so on and so forth. But coming to the other aspect of how the labor unions should respond to this, a lot of the labor unions have been organizing strikes and mass movement, joined with the farmers' agitation and so on and so forth. But definitely there's a concern of making the issue of labor codes a public issue, and trying to transcend from old methods to some new, more modern methods, using the digital platforms, using various social media, trying to capture the youth, trying to make it more appealing. And finally, what is more important is making the labor codes and the farmer laws politically costly for those who have implemented this. So this is how it can translate itself, how these movements against the labor codes can capture the minds of people, capture the minds of youth, and translate itself when it comes to electoral politics. I think this is crucial for the future of the labor codes. So with this, I would like to conclude, and thank you very much. I hand over to Arjun Kumar for the rest.
Thank you. Sir, many questions have come, but it has been answered also. Many comments have also come here and on Facebook. But sir, if you allow, we can go to each of our panelists for just 1 minute intervention as conclusion and way forward. Everyone has been patient. So many of the issues has already risen. So shall we start with Amitava, sir? So 1 minute, just your concluding remarks and way forward.
Yes.
Please go ahead, Amitava, sir.
The concluding remark simply is that the workers are geared up, inching towards the very moment, as Amitavaji has said, towards a increase also.
Audio is the...
Comrade, you are not audible.
Hello.
Sir, some connection related
connectivity issue. Connectivity problem, yes.
Okay. Arjun, we can to him later. You can proceed to the next panelist, please.
Chandrakash, sir, over to you.
देखिए काफी बात हो गई है अब अगर हम ये देखें तो किसान मूवमेंट के साथ लेबर मूवमेंट को जोड़ करके नहीं देखा जा सकता है. लेबर मूवमेंट का एक अलग कंसेप्ट है, और अगर आप देखेंगे तो किसानों की लड़ाई केवल डायरेक्ट उनका उनके उनके सरकार के साथ है. हमारी लड़ाई केवल सरकार के साथ नहीं होता, सेक्टोरल लेवल पर जब हम लड़ते हैं तो हमारे विरुद्ध एक बड़ा मैनेजमेंट, एक बड़ा ग्रुप भी खड़ा रहता है. तो ये जो लेबर मूवमेंट को, हाँ ये बात जरूर है, पब्लिक सपोर्ट कोई आज की बात नहीं है. अगर आप देखेंगे तो लेबर मूवमेंट को इस देश में आजादी के बाद लेबर मूवमेंट को पब्लिक सपोर्ट मिला ही नहीं. और हम लोग शुरू से, अभी तो मान लो अनऑर्गेनाइज्ड सेक्टर की बात कर रहे हैं, लेकिन काफी वर्षों तक लगातार ट्रेड यूनियन ऑर्गेनाइज सेक्टर करते रहा। इसका हमने प्रारंभ में अनऑर्गेनाइज सेक्टर को, इनफॉर्मल सेक्टर, असंगठित क्षेत्र को ट्रेड यूनियन ने आजादी के बाद अपने हाथ में इस लड़ाई को कभी लिया नहीं। यही कारण है कि आप देखेंगे कि एग्रीकल्चर लेबर के मूवमेंट को नक्सल मूवमेंट करार दे दिया गया इस देश में। इसलिए ये एक बात है, कहीं ना कहीं हमारी गलती हुई है, हम में कमी है, उसके बारे में हमको सोचने का जरूरत है। और आज कई बातें जो उभर के आई है कि पब्लिक सपोर्ट हमें कैसे होगा, लेकिन उससे भी ज्यादा जरूरी है कि इस देश में देखिए मल्टीपल जो यूनियन का जो है, हमारे एक फ्रेंड ने, प्रसाद जी ने कहा कि हमारी लड़ाई तो बहुत जगह ग्राउंड लेवल पर आपस में भी हम लड़ते रहते हैं, तो ये ग्राउंड लेवल पर आपस में भी लड़ते रहते हैं, ऊपर में भी अभी हम जितना भी बात यहाँ कर लें, लेकिन वो लड़ाई हमारी अभी भी ऊपर में भी है और नीचे में भी है। तो कहीं ना कहीं हम में कमजोरी है और उस कमजोरी का फायदा या तो बड़े मैनेजमेंट या फिर गवर्नमेंट उठा रही है। तो आज का ये डिस्कशन है, हमको लगता है कि हम लोगों को कुछ ना कुछ इससे अगर सबक मिलता है तो हम सीखने का काम जरूर करेंगे। और आगे काफी बात हो चुकी है, हम ज्यादा चर्चा नहीं करना चाहते हैं, लेकिन लेबर मूवमेंट इस देश से कभी जाने वाला नहीं है, मरने वाला नहीं है। कोई नए फॉर्म में ये लेबर मूवमेंट आएगा। ऐसा नहीं है कि जिग वर्कर और जो प्लेटफॉर्म वर्कर या और जो इनफॉर्मल वर्कर, एग्रीकल्चर वर्कर, इनकी लड़ाई आज खत्म हो जाएगी, ऐसा नहीं है। ये लेबर कोड को आने दीजिए ना, ये लेबर कोड के आने के बाद यदि सरकार किसी भी तरह से इस लेबर कोड को इम्प्लीमेंट कर ही देती है तो आप देखेंगे इस देश में एक नई लड़ाई फिर खड़ी होगी। और ट्रेड यूनियन मूवमेंट का जो ग्रास रूट अगर आप मानते हैं कि अभी कमजोर है, तो ये लेबर कोड हमको मजबूत करेगा और इस लेबर कोड के चलते हमारी एकजुटता भी बढ़ेगी, हम यही कहना चाहते हैं। थैंक यू,
धन्यवाद सर। नाउ मूविंग ऑन टू ब्रिजेश सर, आपके कंक्लूडिंग रिमार्क्स और थॉट्स।
थैंक यू अर्जुन जी, आई थिंक टुडेज डिस्कशन इज, although we have not discussed in the term of way forward, but I think way forward we have identified. Developing connect within ours and within trade union, it's one aspect we have identified. And our both the Nandaji and Venkateshan ji, they have brought us to the point to recognize yourself and recognize the audience. If you will not listen yourself, nobody will listen. And the very next one is, we have to change with the changes. We are not changing ourselves. We can't bring the change, or we can't force others to get change. Design of 60s economy and the trade union thought philosophy based on the 60s economy will not work now. World is discussing 2030 agenda. So we have to come to the point, to the label, to the closer to the issues. If we could change ourselves to this extent, we can change the universe. This might be here. The very difficult task is changing our perception, our mindset, our approach. That is the big issue we need to address. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. And now we are also aspiring for India 2047, New India, 100 year. Yes.
Really? So
many New India things are coming.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Now coming to Amarjeet ma'am, and we'll come back to Amitava, sir. He's also raising hand. Amarjeet ma'am, over to you.
Yes, thank you for giving this opportunity for last comments. I respect the presentation by Dr. Rashmi and Prashant. They have their suggestions, which are well taken, how trade unions should use digital platforms, social media and all, create public perception, the way other sections are fighting, who are making the public perception, etc. All those points were raised. I don't agree that there is intellectual vacuum with the trade unions. I don't agree there.
We have enough resources, all trade unions, whichever center they are, they have this thing. You can say that with that intellectual availability, whatever we have, those intellectual resources, are we able to put them in proper use for developing our movements and all? There I can say. So there is no dearth of intellectual. Sector-wise, we see how matured even even our unskilled worker is much more maturer than even the top class leader of a particular trade unions. So there is no dearth of this thing, because that is question of their life, and they vary in clear language. They explain what they are feeling about. The difficulty of the trade union movement is it's not so simple to have these movements. Even one day's strike means they lose their jobs, many of them, and they lose their kitchens. Nothing will be cooked. They won't be having earning and all. I'm talking of informal economy worker, and formal workers also have to lose their wages when they go for strike. So I won't say there is intellectual vacuum. I will definitely say one needs to know more. One needs to address the new workers which are coming, because continuous changes in the development process happens, and new kinds of workers keep coming, and we are supposed to work on them also. It's also not true that we don't try to work among them, but it's not so easy to mobilize them. To say that the people do not know about this workforce, you look at the number. At present, we are 540 million, 54 crore workers. Out of that, if you remove the government sector, public sector, and little bit formal sector workers, and if you take only the rest of the workers, they are 45 crore plus who are out of this. And when we say 45 crore plus, many of them are married and their family members attached. So you are talking about 100 crore people in India. If their visibility is not there, it's failure of the system also, that their visibility is not there. Not only the failure of trade unions, they don't get focus. Even in media, they don't get focus. But first time, nakedly, it was exposed how our workers suffer during this lockdown period. The people were really surprised how crores of workers out of their homes are working within the states or outside the state. So it got exposed. People were emotional, but then it goes out of the public psyche once again. But I don't deny that we have to build public spaces. We have to build the arguments there. We have to have spaces over there. I definitely agree those points which have been made. And I know that you talk of young leadership to be brought. Well taken. I also should mention that our membership is almost 60, 70, 80% membership is in informal economy workers. Let me make it clear to you. Whatever total membership we have and annual returns we make, and those I tell you, our membership is all 76, between 70 to 80% is informal economy workers. Formal economy workers is only 20%, and in some cases even only 10%. And not that formal economy worker also, most of them are becoming outsourced workers, contract workers, daily workers, and shrinking regular jobs are happening. So there is no way out that the trade unions have to address the contract worker, casual worker, daily worker, informal worker. We have to address this. Otherwise, there is no existence of trade unions, one can ensure. So that is what I'm trying to say. And when we fought in 1920s, and we were fighting before that 1920s, there was no PSUs. PSUs came after 1960 only. So where were we working? We were working among all these workers only who had no rights during British era. And we fought with the Britishers to get our unions to be legalized in 1926. So if we will be thrown back there with these labor codes and rules, so we know fighting is the only way out. So we have, from slavery situations, we have come to this level. And if again slavery will be imposed on us, the workers will fight. Leaders are there or not, workers will fight. And let me inform Prashant and Rashmi, all our workers at the grassroots level in small industries,
industries, in middle industries, all young workers, their leaders are also young, because they have to choose from among those workers only. All the new industries coming up, all those polytechnic trains, ITI trains, trained workers from IITs also, all those youngsters are joining those. All modern technology industries, it is youngster workers. And then they, when they form their unions, their leaders are also young. And that's why I say intellectual dearth is not there. All those people who are working at that level, they give the feedback to others. In unions, it happens that it takes you 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, and then only you are considered to be capable being in the national headquarters. But there also, I do agree, part of the national headquarters also, you should have many of the youngsters around you. There I agree with your point. But it's not true that young leaders are not there. All the down below, you go to industrial area, it is all young leaders. All new industries which have come up in last 20 years or 15 years or 25 years, the people who got recruited and all, many of them even dropped because they could not join back even during lockdown period and post lockdown also. So I want to end up here by telling that we do accept the critical viewpoint. We do try to learn from those critical points, but we do assert that labor history has its very, very deep roots and it is evolved, and this evolution will continue. And if we will get weakened up, we will be in problem. So we have been insisting one industry, one union. If that we achieve in future, then the managements or the governments, the fight will be real. Advantage, working class movement. That would happen, but that's not there. It is true that the unions are fragmented, they are divided, this is true. But it is not true that they are not, even where the unions are not there, the workers are on warpath. Some places where the unions are not there, they fought back and got their lockdown wages released. They fought back and they did not allow management to impose a 12 hours work day. Even in absence of unions there. So once the workers decide to fight, leaders or no leaders, they move ahead. I am visualizing that the days are coming when this whole thing is emerging into the movement forms and nobody will be able to stop it. It will move ahead. Irrespective of governments, irrespective of management, irrespective of even trade unions. But the trade unions' presence will give them direction, will be able to lead them in appropriate direction, not to have anarchy and chaos. That's why unionism is important, and there has to be some leadership of any movement, and that's where the role of trade unions is there. So I am proud we are part of trade unions, and it is not a small thing. You are dealing with almost 100 crore people's lives, because their families also count. They also have to have benefits of the social security, and their people should get proper jobs who are into the labor market from their families. So I would like to end here. Discourse will continue and continue in the next webinars also.
Thank you so much, Amarjit ma'am. And there are also global evidences that this is going forward and also taken by young in many continents across the world. Now, moving on, Amitava sir is here waiting patiently. Amitava sir, would you like to? Yes, please. Please go ahead, sir.
I don't want to reach at the conclusion. My only observation is, and I'm also giving a tip, if trade unions are ignored, if the labor laws are implemented as it has been promulgated, and add to this unemployment situation, landlessness, land loss situation, and the global recession, which is much more prominent in our country, our own economic system, this condition continues, then trade unions have a very serious responsibility. Because the society will be wrecked with the lawlessness, will be wrecked with the different people. They will be violent, they will be looting each other, there will be serious social unrest out of the situation. So trade unions have a serious responsibility.
नो ऑडियो सर
नो ऑडियो ना ठीक नहीं आवाज नहीं आ रही
यस यस सो नेवरदलेस लेट मी मूव अहेड टू प्रशांत सर एंड प्रशांत सर सो मच ऑफ good feedback and response also you have got. There has been many instances also. We are getting some disturbances. Yes, and sir, there has been many policy schemes also, Mudra, PM Swanidhi, PM Atmanirbhar Rozgar Yojana, and there has also been so many of new initiative, EPFO, ESIC, new dimensions also coming gig workers. How do you see as your concluding and way forward remark for the deliberation of today? Prashant sir, your way forward.
First, labor market will only grow and will thrive. How we deal with it as a subject will vary on who is looking at it at what point of time. If I'm a journalist, I'm slowly looking at labor market from a social sector to an economic sector, it's a consumer economy sector. Trade union may look at it from a different perspective, but labor market in a country like India will be there and nobody can ignore it. How can you ignore 50% of your people right now? So 500 million people, or let's say 475 to 520 million labor market, you cannot ignore that segment. But it depends on how you treat that segment. Whether you want to look at that segment as somebody who are low level guys or just labor class, or you want to look at them as your human resource will build the economy. So I think I will leave with this comment, because no government, no organization, no media house, no academician can ever ignore 50% of its own people, its own human resource, which is building its economy. How we look at it will decide where we are taking this country and its economy.
Thank you so much, sir. And it's almost supper time for everyone. So let me just finally, formally propose a vote of thanks. So thank you everyone for joining this evening and being so patient, all our panelists and also the participants here also and on Facebook Live, for this very important deliberation today, a panel discussion on the future of labor codes, impact and way forward from the trade union's perspective. Under our series, The State of Employment and Livelihood, hashtag employment debate, organized by IMPRI, Indian Social Institute and Counterview. And we are so thankful for everyone to be so lucid and so insightful and forthcoming on their suggestion on this issue. And I'm sure we'll all come back to this issue as we progress ahead this year. And I wish thanks to all of our panelists, Amarjeet ma'am, Chand Prakash sir, Virjay sir, and Amitava Guha sir, our discussion, Prashant Kenanda sir, and Rashmi Venkatesh ma'am, and our moderator, Professor K.R. Shamsundar, for taking this together, and Dr. Denzil sir, for guiding us and supervising this so well. For academicians, it's become quite tough to handle all these things. But thank you, all of you, from all of us, for putting this together. And we wish you all to take care and hope to catch you on future episodes of our hashtag employment debate. Thank you, and please take care of yourself.
Thank you and good health to everybody.
Thanks to our.
Thanks to all.
Namaskar.
Very engaging.
Namaskar. Good night.
Namaskar. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.